definitely kind of a slow year for the Hot 100 and a slower year for me giving a shit, because I really didn't. And I didn't keep up with the charts for most of 2023 at all. It was pretty boring to me, but there was actually a lot of competition for this list. So I'm using the Billboard Year-End Hot 100, Billboard Year-End Global 200, and Spotify Global Top 50. I'm excluding songs that peaked in other years, songs I've already talked about in other lists, and Christmas songs. Basically, everything else is eligible. So without further ado, I'm just gonna get straight into it. Okay, fine, I'll give you this one.
I got no time to lose. Nikita Donharu.
I'm gonna be honest, I find NewJeans to be one of the most overhyped groups out right now. And while I get how their song is fresh for K-pop and the pop charts as a whole, and their youthful energy is infectious, and I have no doubt that they are all very talented, but their music feels like TikTok bait most of the time, and most of their songs range from just decent to completely atrocious. I'm looking at you, Cookie, and Minhee Jan, you are not off the hook. I won't be buying albums or merch of these girls anytime soon, that's for sure. But what the hell, Ditto is their best song, the League of Legends song notwithstanding, and it's not even close. Ditto may be the perfect pop song. From that slow burn intro with those falsetto vocals, to the clattering club beat that gives off youthful energy, the hand clap percussion, the girls flawlessly switching off lines with a talk singing rhythm going into the chorus, with the extended falsetto notes and bass buildup to the full second half of the chorus and its payoff, the song doesn't waste a single second of runtime. This might be one of NewJeans' only songs that's actually over 3 minutes, and I am so glad they made it that way. It doesn't do anything to reinvent the wheel. It's just a cute song about wanting a crush to like you back, but damn, do they sell it. I consider Ditto to be the perfect execution of a time-honored trope, and this is so much better than Cupid that it's not even funny. When it comes to making great pop songs, you can always thank the Swedes. Ditto, this is a perfect execution of an established formula, but this time it's a viscerally passionate love song with a load of unhealthy obsession, with an absolutely stellar vocal performance, and a lush dramatic pop production I have been missing in American pop music for years. Proof that the foreign charts are better. Musically, I would describe Tattoo as if Adele made an Ellie Goulding song, except this has richer production than anything Ellie Goulding ever made in the 2010s. There are a few vocalists that can make cookie-cutter pop songs with out an original line in sight so compelling, but Loreen is one of those vocalists. She can make any song sound as big and full as possible while completely selling the obsessed lovesickness of the lyrics. Did I mention she is a fantastic performer? Between the last song and this one, America, you really need to step it up. This is what pop music should sound like. Bunny. After I loved Da Kitty in 2021 and Titi Me Pregunto in 2022, I definitely get why Bad Bunny is as popular as he is. The lyrics to this one are pretty generic, just about wanting to fuck a girl again after she has left him and wondering if she remembers their one night stand, but you know, in Spanish. Bad Bunny delivers a great performance here, but what really does it for me is this beat. The song manages to keep a dark atmosphere with those slow sections with desaturated synths, gunshot, and siren sound effects as Bad Bunny lets loose with the vocals before sliding into an insanely hyped beat that reminds me a lot of Jersey Club. This song has a lot of the same appeal to me that I Just Wanna Rock by Lil Uzi Vert does, but while that was an ad-libbed fragment, it was barely over 2 minutes, this is a fully fleshed out song. It's nearly 4 minutes, but it doesn't feel long at all given how hyped up this gets me. But the darker parts keep it from being an all-out party song, and I think that's cool. It has a really unique atmosphere that I just love, as I haven't heard many other songs like this on the charts. Bad Bunny continues to stand out from the crowd of Latin singers and make a fair share of bangers. I just wish his albums weren't 80 minutes long. I'm sorry, I can barely listen to music for that long in a language I can speak. I have ADHD. But yeah, definitely check this out if you missed it.
I like it, like it.
2. I'm not really sure how this group keeps putting out the best sounding pop songs ever, but here we are. After praising Love Dive last year, I think this song is even better. Even though Afterlike is better than both of them, but I digress. And Baddie is certainly a song that exists, but back on topic. I Am is a glittery synth pop song with synthesized strings, drum fills coming in at the perfect time, and one of the most euphoric choruses I've heard in a while. I particularly love that drum fill leading up to the final chorus. I get chills down my spine every time. The song has a positive and inspiring message of chasing your dreams and carving your own path, and the song sounds celebratory to boot. It's been a hard year for me, well, quite frankly, a hard several years, and it took a long time, but I'm finally finding positivity, and sad and dark songs are some of my favorites of all time and helped me through a lot, but there needs to be a balance. The first verse has some really pretty backing vocals, and the pre-chorus, well, damn, the pre-chorus is just excellent. It feels very driving with the I'm on my way bit. Building to the chorus, which plays the anti-drop tricks and takes place in 2 parts. All the instruments drop out, save for some light percussion to focus on the vocals, and they slowly come back in before the main chorus kicks in. Playing the same melody over a lush, pulsing synth background, the second verse has a trap breakdown with that slowdown sound before the drums kick back in, leading back to the pre-chorus and the bridge. Everything cuts once again, besides ticking percussion and strings, to focus on the girls' vocal harmonies. It builds to the final line with the synth hits, 1-2-3, 1-2-3, fly up. And then, before going into that last chorus, which is again perfect. If we had perfect construction from Ditto and Tattoo, this is the best of the best. This is what pop music is supposed to sound like. By the way, Either Way is an absolutely gorgeous song that practically made me cry, and Hypnosis was one of my favorite songs of the year, so yeah, I only see good things coming from IVE in the future. Is this cheating? I feel like this is cheating. Listen, your arm feeling nice wrapped around my shoulder, and I had a feeling that I belong. The rest of this list is going to be a lot more serious, and we're starting with Luke Combs' straightforward cover of Tracy Chapman's legendary Fast Car. He doesn't try to improve the song because he can't. He just sings it with his heart. And yeah, I get Luke Combs and I get Fast Car. It feels like cheating to have this on the list, but I don't care. This is a damn good cover of a damn excellent song. Those melodies that build to the chorus give me chills no matter what version it is, and the lyrics feel even more potent now than they did when the song first came out. I also noticed that Luke Combs doesn't change the gender of the lyrics. I work in the market as a checkout girl, and I have some questions. Should we pair him up with Dua Lipa singing I'm Not the Man You Think I Am at All? Okay, but seriously, I don't have much else to say about this. It's Fast Car and it fucking hits. Sometimes you don't need anything else. Now for the polar opposite of the last song. This is the most hyper song on the list, but don't let its cutesy veneer fool you. The original song is in Japanese, and that's the version that goes on the list, but thankfully there is an English version for stupid people like me to make sense of this. Idol is about obsession, a parasocial relationship with an idol. In this context, who seems to be a singer, from the perspective of a crazed fangirl who mentions she hasn't eaten today, asks her idol what she has eaten, and calls her the perfect and most ultimate idol, putting her on a pedestal as if she can do no wrong. By the third verse, however, she keeps saying she is telling herself lies, that her idol loves her, and she has never loved anyone before. Her idol worship has become so extreme that she doesn't know how to function in polite society, and all she wants to do is meet her idol, which, girl, relatable. I'm not gonna tackle this and say, wow, how stupid of her. She needs to touch grass, because that's missing the point. We all have idols. I definitely spend time thinking and worrying about my idol and his well-being. I don't believe it's a lie that he loves all his fans, but idols, even those who genuinely love their fans, don't love fans on a personal level. And I've witnessed people who are so deluded into trying to control their idol's actions or want their idol to marry them. This is why we have otakus and seiseins, guys. The chorus of at the beginning that sings, "You're my savior, you're my saving grace," is so potent to me because I believe that those who you idolize for their talent, art, personality, or what have you, can genuinely help you through dark times. I'm not going to pretend that sometimes a hobby or interest, whether that be a thing or person, maybe the only thing I have to cling to in a fucked up mental state, and I think that can be okay, whatever keeps you alive, but you have to remember that your idols can make mistakes and are human, which for me makes them more relatable, but for some reason, a lot of stans want their idols to be perfect. And that they have their own private lives and don't know you personally, you have to learn to live for yourself and craft meaningful relationships. It's a matter of finding a healthy balance where you are inspired by your idol and they help you through hard times, but you also know that you're your own person with your own life and goals. You have to forge your own path for yourself and not engage in otaku behavior because that's creepy and an invasion of the idol's privacy, and also unhealthy for you to devote your life entirely to someone who doesn't know you personally. So what I'm saying is, it's okay to have idols, and it's okay if your idol has helped you out in a hard place, but don't become an otaku, guys. It's embarrassing. Anyway, now for the music. This song is batshit insane. It's like glitter vomit of fast-paced synth lines, piano, random breakdowns, and a vocal performance that absolutely sells the otaku character that Lila Sikudu is playing here. Even without the context of the lyrics, the song is insanely catchy and chaotic. And more than a pop song, there are elements of chiptune, symphonic, rock, trap, classical, and EDM. I highly recommend listening to this song with headphones on because it's a trip. Say what you want about Calm Down, but this is the best Afrobeats hit of the year. Cause you see people don't really know you. I'm a person with a good deal of social anxiety and some pretty serious trust issues due to past trauma. This is a song about drinking to cope with social isolation, depression, and just feeling isolated from others. I don't drink, and my coping mechanisms consist of hiding in my room and unhealthily scrolling Instagram, but I get the sentiment. The song sounds great as Lee Bianca delivers a smooth, heartfelt performance, and I like how minimal the production is. It fits the song perfectly. The sentiment of people don't really know you is the title line of the song for a reason, because it's true. Most of the time, we hide our true selves from others. We tell people we're okay when we're not, or we act different from how we are because we have to. As someone of high-functioning autism and ADHD, as well as near-constant anxiety about something, anything my brain can come up with, I often find myself checking out at work or in public or acting upbeat and chipper to get through the day when that's just not where I'm at. And putting on that facade is exhausting, and yeah, I feel this. The part where Lee Bianca asks if anyone has checked on her or looked for her is really damning of how people just kind of ignore what's going on. It's sad, and this song captures it perfectly. To say this one really resonated with me would be an understatement, and I hope to hear more great things from Lee Bianca. Goddamn vampire. Yeah, I know y'all hate this, apparently, and yeah, I get it. I'll be talking about Guts a bit more in my next year-end video, but this whole album hit. And yeah, I get how the writing is clumsy or how Olivia wears her heart on her sleeve and reveals all, but damn it, that's why I love her. Of course she's not out of her teenage awkwardness, she's 20. People don't grow up overnight, guys. People who write like Adele are few and far between, and Olivia writes like a young Taylor Swift, and that's a compliment. Okay, now that we got that out of the way, I love the lyrics. Fame fucker is a great line, screw you. I think my favorite thing about Vampire is how it starts off as a slow piano ballad and builds in intensity to a much faster, more frantic groove. I'm going to share some of my favorite lyrics now. How's the castle built of people that you pretend to care about is very damning, and oh, what mesmerizing, paralyzing, fucked up little thrills. Just great songwriting. But then we get the real kicker. In a toxic relationship when I was 19, and the guy I was dating was 23. It was my first relationship ever, and I was in way over my head. He had a lot of exes and was a walking red flag, but I didn't even notice or brush it off. And after we broke up, he hooked up with someone even younger and less emotionally mature than me, and yeah, I get it. I hate guys who do that, taking advantage of inexperienced partners only to end up breaking their hearts, and yeah, this song not only sounds amazing, but it was extremely relatable to me. I get those who hate it, but maybe it's not for you. Vampire is my song of the year. Let me have this. I like it, like you. Forgive me, love. I like it, like you, like. Now look in your eyes. I like it, like. I spent a small section of my dishonorable mentions on my worst list making fun of Brits, but then I said at least escapism was good. I think that's an understatement. Just a heartbroken bitch, high heels, 6 inch in the back of the nightclub, sipping champagne. I don't trust any of these bitches I'm with in the. This was locked in at number one for the longest time. Escapism is similar to People in that it's about a girl clubbing to try to escape her problems. This song is unapologetically British, which I like. It feels like Ray's authentic self. Those dissonant fake strings may be off-putting for some, but that's kind of the point. Her delivery is perfect, the lyrics are perfect, and almost feel like a stream of consciousness doing everything to numb her emotional pain. Yeah, I've been there. I was also there in 2019 and 2018. Everything came crashing down in 2020 when I had to learn how to feel again, and yeah, it hurts. I've used fandoms, music, idols, just about anything as escapism, and sometimes it's necessary, but you can't push your problems away forever. But feeling sucks, and Ray doesn't want to feel horrible again like she did before. And damn, the bridge with that piano gives me chills. Out of reach. Out of touch, too numb, I don't feel no way, toast up so what? Street small, but it go both ways. So you'll run, yeah, but you can't escape, sunset in the maze. True escapism is impossible, and Ray has discovered this. Numbing herself hasn't made her feel better, but she is still desperate for any form of relief, and yeah, I felt this. The distorted outro is the perfect way to end the song, and this is a song that fully earns its 4.5 minute runtime. She's completely lost it by the end, high out of her mind on something and not remembering anything, and yeah, this song's a fucking masterpiece. But before we get to what beat it, let's go through some honorable mentions. This song, Getting Justice, was one of the best things to happen in 2023. Honestly, as someone who's always been a fan of Taylor Swift's poppier stuff, this is how you do it. I'm obsessed. The melodies are super pleasant, and that bridge is one of the best, just one of the best things ever. But did anyone else realize this song sounds like Strawberries and Cigarettes by Troye Sivan from 2018? I guess she ripped him off, but then Chappelle Rowan ripped her off with My King is Karma, so who am I to talk? Honestly, this feels more like a 2022 hit, and I'm annoyed that I didn't talk about this in its time because this is a great song. However, Overplay has completely killed it for me. This is one of her best written songs just ever. I love songs about being a crazed insomniac. Taylor Swift plays the anti-hero so much better than the villain. She's annoying, but you'll always end up rooting for her anyway. Taylor is just crazy like that. Admitting that you're the problem is half the battle, sweetie. Now cut out your carbon emissions. A really nice Afrobeat song that has one of Selena Gomez's best features to date. She sounds perfect on a song like this. Her husky delivery is subdued and sexy and works perfectly on a chill beat like this. She needs to stop being on things like Ice Cream and do more of this. I liked Kill Bill, but wasn't as hot on it as some people. This, on the other hand, is just really nice. I kind of want to listen to this album now since I've liked all the songs I've heard from it for this video. Now, this was the SZA song that I really fell in love with. I was really hoping this would make the list proper, but the competition was steep. This song has a gorgeous melody and stays beautifully acoustic throughout. You have to have the right kind of voice to pull off a song like this, and SZA absolutely does. If I'm real, I deserve less is a really great line. Her crooning falsetto at the end of the chorus is absolutely gorgeous. This is a song about that awkward post-breakup denial where you think you could make it work and get back together, but it's just not possible, and she hit the nail on the head with this one. I don't know if I've ever mentioned this before, but I really love synthwave, and this is a pretty good entry into the genre. Jimin's stylistic singing works well here, even though I do think his technique needs a little more time in the oven, but what really carries this song is the production. When that chorus percussion kicks in, I feel so euphoric. The little synth drop after the chorus reminds me a lot of The Weeknd, and this song is just overall a really nice vibe. It's extremely 80s, but with modern electronic production, and I am so here for it. While I'm here, I want to mention that Standing Next to You by Jungkook charted too late in the year to be eligible for my list, but it's excellent and would be on the list proper if it was included. This is a song that you can tell came out in 2010, as it has that dated blocky percussion, but at the same time, it feels so timeless. It feels right at home in the modern pop and R&B scene, and I want to thank TikTok for making this little gem a hit. The pitch shifting was off-putting at first, but I can look past it when Miguel sounds this romantic. I don't care what anyone says, this is fucking great. It might have made the list proper if it was longer. I don't remember any songs I've heard from Lil Uzi Vert before, but damn, they work so well on this beat. The dark synth fuzz at the beginning as Uzi holds a note and lets it go before the song goes into this incredibly hyped Jersey club beat. I just wish this song was longer to really get me hyped, but sadly, this is the TikTok era of music. I didn't hear great things about Austin, and I couldn't get through 24 Karat Toothache, but I really love this. I thought it was a shoe-in for this list, but I didn't realize how many great songs came out this year. Post Malone hopping on this folk rock groove feels very 90s and suits his voice super well. I respect this song. This feels like what Circle should have been. This should have been so much bigger. Great stuff. Look, I'm not much of a country guy. I've said that before. And this was the year I felt most out of touch with the American pop charts, but I get Luke Combs. Would I listen to this frequently? No, but I can respect how well written this is and how the chorus just explodes. This is how you make a slow burn of a song that uses similes perfectly. For her first song in quite some time, Rihanna delivered a hauntingly beautiful piano ballad for the Black Panther Wakanda Forever soundtrack. I saw that movie in theaters and this was the perfect ending song for it, but even without the movie, it's an absolutely gorgeous song that just missed this list. I guess there were more good songs this year than last year, since I was sure this was going to make the list, but it just missed it. And yeah, this is fucking great. I loved Something in the Orange last year, and this somber country tune with its gorgeous string swells creates such a lurid atmosphere. Kacey Musgraves sounds great on this as well, and making this a duet was the perfect choice. If country is going to be popular, I'm glad that this seems to be the predominant sound going forward. This has to be one of the most quirky and fun songs I've heard on the charts in a while. I haven't heard a song with a banjo that rocks this hard in a while, and this takes me back to the 2012 indie boom in the best way possible, and Post Malone was the perfect choice to pull in for this remix. I will stick by Post Malone making rock and folk is insanely better than him making hip-hop. More of this in 2024, please. I really wanted this to make the list so I could heap praise on a country song that isn't a cover of Fast Car, but damn, I think I get it now. I got it for a second with Blake Shelton's God's Country back in 2019, but this is better than that song in every way. I get chills when that chorus kicks in. This is definitely a country song that leans heavily into power pop production, even right down to having a Say It Ain't So chords on the bridge, and it's great. I wish that ripping guitar part after the second chorus turned into a full-on solo, but hearing so much fresh and organic instrumentation in the TikTok era and a song that dares to go above 3 minutes makes me so happy. I have no idea who Corey Kent is, but I might check out more of his stuff because this is excellent. Well, this one was a grower. Telepatia in 2021 was an absolutely magical song, and while I don't think this is as good, it's still smooth, fun, and, well, slutty, and I mean that as a compliment. That weird warbling synth in the background fits the vibe very well, and Kali delivers a spectacular performance as always. We need more hot woman winning. I actually like Tate McRae, despite absolutely trashing You Broke Me First back in 2021, and she fits on this EDM groove surprisingly well. This is just a fun house song with a nice vocal performance. Also, Greedy is great and is probably going to make next year's list. Camp, in the absolute best way possible. The K-pop community seems split 50-50 on loving and hating us, and I get it, I totally do. But those of you who hate this might hate fun or women or both. Please know that that's a joke. I don't actually think you hate women if you dislike this song, but come on now. I'm not a woman, and even I feel like a hot girl listening to this. The song just exudes confidence, and the cringy lyrics make it better because of how unapologetic it is. I'm also a sucker for those pop-punk guitars on the chorus. Great stuff. And now, let's get to my number one.
I like it. I like it, like it, like it. 목소리 매우 높. I like it, like it, like it. 나 walk in my your eyes. I like it, like it, like it. 가깝게 미나고자 손 놓고 걸어서
event. I'm bad, I'm bad. Was it ever going to be anything else? I don't know how to feel, but I wanna try. I still haven't seen Barbie, so I'm judging this purely from a standalone viewpoint, and fuck, she did it again. I made a 15-minute segment on Happier Than Ever in my 2021 best list back when I was unscripted, And that is one of my favorite songs of all time because of how visceral it was. Billy doing the hushed and quiet songs never did much for me. I never got Your Power despite many people loving it. I get it now. This song is for me what Your Power was for so many others. The existential dread and angst of this song is used in the context of Barbie with lyrics about how the narrator is something you paid for and not real, but it also works as an examination of Billy as a young musician and entertainer, how everything must feel strange or unreal at times, and how the persona she has crafted for herself is only part of the story, and how entertainers or idols are seen as commodities to be paid for rather than actual people, and damn, this hit. Her haunting delivery makes an incredibly sparse piano ballad feel so weighty and important. The multi-tracking is gorgeous. This feels like a more mature version of When the Party's Over. And yeah, I'll be honest, I've had a lot of existential angst for like the last several years, and I still do. But this year I turned 21 and I had to come to terms with the fact that I'm an adult now and I have no idea what I'm doing. My adolescence is a blur of trauma and suppressed memories, and the world just feels like it's going downhill, and I question why I bother at all if I can't just work on my passions and be happy. The line where Billy says, "I think I forgot how to be happy," really hit me, as through my adolescence, I lost my childlike innocence, and for a while, I had emotionally numbed myself so much that I couldn't feel even positive emotions. It was just a lot of nothing, and I want you to all know that feeling and healing is painful, but it's worth it for the good moments, but it makes sense to feel lost, and I'm still trying to figure my shit out, and I think Billy made a song that most people can relate to. If not explicitly about growing up, this song resonates so much with that sentiment, and Billy being close to my own age just exemplifies that experience. Celebrity or not, growing up is losing a part of yourself. I'll be talking about this more in future videos when I talk about my other favorite songs of the year, but yeah, Billy did it again. She delivered a legendary piece of art. This has been Raya Lexington, and I appreciate those of you who stuck around till the end. This has got a little personal, but stay tuned for my ranking of every album that I heard in 2023. If you liked this, please like, comment, subscribe, and share with friends. Also, feel free to follow the socials and my link tree and join my Discord server. Links are in the description, and I'll see you all in the next one. Bye!